Hari Om Tat Sat. We will begin with the chanting of the mantra Om three times all together, and it will be followed by the chanting mantras. Please close your eyes. Keep your spine and head vertical and aligned. Become aware of the whole body and relax the whole body. Be aware of the steadiness of the body. Observe the steadiness and immobility of the whole body. Take the awareness to the eyebrow center now. And at the eyebrow center, visualize a small flame, like the flame of a candle. And with the image of the flame at the eyebrow center, we will chant all together the mantra Om. After me. Om Sahana Vavatu Sahano Bhunaktu.
Om Sahana Vavatu Sahano Bhunaktu.
Sahaviryam Karavavahe.
Sahaviryam Karavavahe.
Tejas Vinavadhitamastu.
Tejas Vinavadhitamastu.
Ma Vidvishavahe.
Ma Vidvishavahe.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
I feel very happy to be here with all of you today, and that happiness is for many reasons. First, we are a small world of yoga in ourselves, and 33 countries are represented here. Second, Venice is a historical city which has linked East and West. And this gathering also is a meeting of East and West, and a beautiful city on water. And third, that we are going to be discussing about the subject of yoga. And yoga is my subject. And I can speak a lot on this subject.
E posso parlare molto su questo argomento.
But in order to understand yoga, one has to understand the life first. Because although in the West, yoga is known as physical, mental or spiritual yoga, and in the physical yoga you have good plenty of stretching and back twisting and bending exercises. Then in the psychological yoga there are the practices of concentration and meditation. And in the spiritual dimension of yoga there is the cultivation of the positive qualities in life. And this is how people in general have understood yoga till today. But looking at the development and the growth of yoga through the centuries, one comes to understand that yoga plays four roles in the life of an individual. The first role of yoga is that it is a practice. Second role of yoga is yoga sadhana. Third role of yoga is yogic lifestyle. And fourth role of yoga is imbibing the yogic culture. And if you look at yoga from this perspective, you will understand the relevance of yoga in our life today. And not only the relevance in relation to our life today, but also the final outcome in the experience of development, of evolution, which we can have in this life. And this understanding of yoga has been the teaching and the vision of Swami Shivananda as well as Swami Satyananda, the two masters or the luminaries of our tradition. But this yoga has to be linked with our life, and therefore need to understand life is also important. And in order to understand life, let us use the example of infinite space and infinite time. In infinite space and infinite time, the line of existence, life, is a continuous flat line. And in this flat line, at times, there is a spike coming up. And that spike represents you, the life which we experience, confined to a moment in space and a range of time. And when that spike comes down, again we become part of the eternal space and eternal time. So in this flat line of existence, in eternal time and space, we are only the spikes that come up. And that is our life, that is our existence. And it is that spike on the flat line which represents our time, our space, and our perceptions of the world during a particular moment. And this spike is our life, your life, my life, his life, everyone's life. So, it is in this life that we experience the development or the destruction of human faculties and consciousness. In the past, thinkers have thought about the role of life in greater scheme of things. Just as today we think of our life in relation to society, in relation to our position and status, just as we think about financial gains and losses, once upon a time people thought about their life in relation to universe, cosmos and divine nature. And they tried to discover the relationship of ourselves as an individual with this universal experience and existence. And at that time they discovered that human body and human life is nothing but an expression of consciousness and energy. And the body, the senses, only become a medium through which the consciousness and the energy expresses itself. So, the way to deal with consciousness and energy, the way to awaken the forces and the qualities of consciousness and energy was devised into a system known as Tantra. And the word Tantra itself means way to liberate the energy and expand the horizons of consciousness. And the philosophy or the idea of human being as an expression of consciousness and energy was developed in Tantra. And according to Tantra, self-realization or God-realization or freedom, they are the outcome of an awakened consciousness and awakened energy. And it is the same consciousness and energy which is confined by the mind and by the senses, which become responsible for our physical existence. So yoga came in as an offshoot or a branch of Tantra to direct one's energies to understand the human consciousness, to awaken the human consciousness, to understand the energy, and to free the energy contained in this body. So the foundations of yoga are in Tantra. And the purpose of yoga is to work with human consciousness to sublimate the restrictive and the negative tendencies, and also to awaken the energy field of the body, which helps in the harmonization of human character. So, the main purpose or the main focus of yoga is to manage the levels of consciousness and energy that we are able to experience in our life. But when yoga came out in the mid-1950s to society from its habitat in the Himalayas, it came out as a physical practice with more focus on the body and the different states that body can achieve through the performance and practices of asanas. And in the beginning, yoga was used for maintenance of the physical body, for trimming the body, for losing weight, for getting into shape. And then later on, with the new discoveries in yoga about the different practices, yoga became a way of stress management. Then it became a way to internalize the consciousness and to awaken the dormant faculties. Everyone thought that they can be realized with the practice of yoga in a very short time, forgetting one thing, that evolution takes its own time. A child who is born today takes many years to grow up. A seed that is planted today takes many years to grow into a big tree. So how can a few practices of meditation which you decide to practice give you enlightenment in 1 week or 1 month or 1 year? But nevertheless, people did become overnight prophets with yoga, with their eyes on profit. And today, yoga is seen as an alternative lifestyle to manage the influences, the negative influences of our present lifestyle. And now let us look at the four different dimensions of yoga: yoga practice, yoga sadhana, yoga lifestyle, and yoga culture. When you come to practice yoga out of your own need, like you may have some back problem and you want to help yourself with the exercises, fine. You use yoga for your particular need. You might want to use yoga to manage your stress and anxiety levels. You may want to dabble in certain practices of meditation, and you choose either this one or that one or this one or that one. And when you find that you have either attained the result or the result seems too far, then you drop the practice. And then sometime later again, inspired by somebody or some idea or some thought, you start again. Then again you stop and go on a sabbatical for a few months. So this on and off dabbling in yoga and using yoga for personal purpose is what I define as yoga practice. And it remains a yoga practice. You do not go beyond that level of the personal needs. And 90% of yoga practitioners fall in this category, who practice yoga because they feel their body needs it, or because they feel light and energetic, or because they want to deal with their stress and anxiety. And that purpose is very much mundane and gross. Then, if this is the situation with yoga practice, what do we call yoga sadhana? Yoga has defined certain aims for itself. The first aim of yoga is harmony through discipline. And that is the first sutra of Patanjali as well. Artha yoga anushasanam. Discovering the harmonious nature of being through discipline, that is purpose number one of yoga. Second aim of yoga, mind management, managing the dissipated states of mind, chitta vritti. And then the third aim of yoga is to develop awareness to such an extent where you can become the observer of your actions. And the Raj Yoga of Patanjali defines these three main aims of yoga in the first three opening statements. And when you practice yoga to either discipline yourself so that the harmony can be experienced, or when you practice yoga to manage the modifications of mind, or you practice yoga to cultivate the awareness to such an extent where you become the observer of yourself, then this practice of yoga is called as yoga sadhana. Sadhana means attaining perfection through constant effort. And attainment of personal discipline, management of mind, and cultivation of consciousness are the three defined aims of Raj Yoga, which constitute sadhana. Now, very few people come to this point of practice because people actually don't like to be disciplined, or they don't want to discipline themselves, because the belief is that discipline involves too many restrictions. But from the yogic perspective, discipline does not involve too much restriction. Rather, it is fine-tuning of the personal radio that you need to do to get clear signal. You know, when you first turn on the radio and it is not on a station, it receives the noise. Same thing happens in TV. If it is not properly tuned, all you see is the white snow. Now imagine that on one TV screen, when you turn on the TV, you get to see Rai Uno, Rai Due, Rai Tre. Which one are you going to look at? You can't look at anyone, because all three are superimposing their images on top of each other. But when the tuning is right, then one channel will come. One station will come on a particular channel, another station will come on another channel, another station will come on another channel. and there will be clarity of image and sound. Just as that tuning is necessary to define the frequency of each channel, personal tuning is necessary to define the frequency of each expression of consciousness and mind and energy. And that is the concept of discipline, that we tune ourselves to the right frequencies in relation to our thoughts, to our desires, to our expectations, to our needs, to our strengths, to our weaknesses. So fine-tuning of this personal receiver is the aim of discipline in yoga. And therefore discipline does not mean restrictions, and definitely not in Sanskrit. The word that is used is governing the subtle nature of human personality. And it is this concept of Sanskrit, anushasan, which has been translated as discipline, which is incorrect. Fine-tuning of personality is discipline. And this happens when you are able to follow the progressions in yoga in a systematic way. When Swami Shivananda taught yoga to his disciples about 50 years ago, when he was first teaching yoga, he said in the yoga practice there has to be a blend of different techniques. In one yoga session, one should practice 5 items of yoga. One practice of yama, one practice of niyama, asana, pranayama, and one of concentration. And he laid these guidelines. And even today in the ashram environment, we follow these guidelines of practicing asanas, pranayamas, concentration, and one yama and niyama in a yoga session. Because he used to say that in order to fine-tune the personality, you have to practice yoga to access all the different areas of expression, sensorial distractions and disturbances and imbalances to be managed with the practices of asanas, pranic imbalances to be rectified with the practices of pranayamas, dissipated mental energies to be channeled with the practice of concentration, creating a change in the behavior pattern of mind, in the attitudes of mind, by adopting and living one yama and one niyama. And when this practice is done in the right manner, in the right combination, then one attains the physical, the psychological harmony, and the personality is fine-tuned. So, in relation to sadhana, the subject that I was talking about, yoga sadhana, the first attempt in this process is to attain discipline or control over the subtle processes of personality. When we follow the aims set out in yoga to achieve, then our yoga practice is yoga sadhana, consistent, continued effort to attain the goal set by yoga. Previously I had said 90% of people practice yoga practice. Now in this case, out of the remaining 10, maybe 5% practice yoga sadhana, because it involves very intense work with oneself and constant observation of oneself. Then in the third, where yoga becomes a lifestyle, there is a percentage of about 3 who come in this category. Because what is yogic lifestyle? When you begin to express in your life the attainments of yoga, then it becomes yogic lifestyle. When you begin to live the principles of yoga and apply the techniques of yoga to manage your day-to-day situations, then yoga becomes a lifestyle. And at that moment, yoga is not a practice anymore which you do for specific time in the morning or afternoon or night. Rather, it becomes a natural expression of life. I remember that once I was having a children's camp, and one day we had practiced pranayamas, little kids from the age of 6 onwards, and I told the kids, whenever you are in any danger, just hold your breath and danger will go away. Then about 4 days later, some children had gone to play in a water tank, and one 5-year-old kid fell down in the water tank. Of course, there was a bit of shouting, and I happened to be nearby, so I jumped in and pulled him out. And when he came out, he was smiling. And I looked at him. There was no heart to be angry because he was smiling. So I said, "What did you do down there?" And he said, "I was holding my breath."
E lui ha detto, "Stavo trattenendo il respiro."
I was holding my breath. A simple statement. But that made me think that if one little boy can understand the instruction and use that understanding in a difficult situation like being drowned to hold his breath, that yogic understanding becomes part of his life in course of time. Let us look at an example of stress. When stress accumulates in life, then it begins to affect the mind and the human behavior. Sometimes it will come in form of sleeplessness. Sometimes it will manifest in form of hypertension. Whatever its form may be, how do you deal with that? I mean, it will be easier to simply pop a pill in the mouth and go about the normal business. If you have hypertension, have a pill to reduce the hypertension. If you are having insomnia, then have a tablet to sleep. And this is what the general people would tend to do. But if you had yoga in your life and you were able to manage your stress with Bhramari pranayam, you would not require a medication to manage that outcome of stress. So what would be the scenario here for a person who is using yoga to manage stress? Maybe at workplace that person will go to the bathroom, close the door, sit down and practice Bhramari 10 times in the bathroom, then come out back to work. Or maybe that person will come home in the evening and instead of sitting down with a glass of beer or wine, just practice 10 minutes of yoga nidra before going into the other mode of life. And if in this manner you use yoga at different times during the day to manage your own conditions and states of body and mind, you will avoid a lot of the physiological and psychological illnesses and stresses which come up in our life. So when yoga becomes a lifestyle, it is not something that you practice 1 hour in the morning, Wednesdays and Fridays with your yoga teacher in your yoga center. Rather, you can use yoga every hour to manage different conditions which you are confronting. Traveling in car, deep abdominal breathing can happen. Pranayamas can be practiced in office, in the bathroom of the office. It should be clean. Yoga nidra can be practiced during the afternoon or evening just to release the accumulated stress. 5 minutes of breath awareness can be practiced in the office to clear the mind of confusions and problems and to have clarity. And in this manner, yoga becomes part of the natural behavior of life. And that is known as yogic lifestyle. When we begin to use yoga in day-to-day routines and activities, and as you become more fluent in this use of yoga in the normal routines and daily life, the mind and the behavior and the attitude reflect the yogic awareness. And that reflection of yogic awareness is known as yogic culture. And about 2% of people achieve this. And this is how I wish to present yoga during this gathering, as practice, as sadhana, as lifestyle, and as culture. Because ultimately, we have to come to nourish our own personalities and nature. And once we are able to recognize this role of yoga in our life, can we actually appreciate yoga? And therefore, we begin with yoga practice, the first stage. What are the things that we can practice? Hatha yoga can be practiced. Parts of Raja yoga can be practiced. And Hatha yoga and Raja yoga together constitute complete yoga for the first level. And today I'll only deal in brief with Hatha yoga and Raja yoga as our practice. Hatha yoga is generally considered in the West to be the physical yoga. Raja yoga is considered in the West to be the part of the mental yoga. But Hatha yoga is not physical and Raja yoga is not mental. They are practices which bring about a change in the normal behavior of body. They are practices which bring a change in the normal conditioning of energy and muscles and the organs of the body. Hatha yoga is the yoga of balancing the solar and the lunar forces in the body. The solar force is known as prana shakti and the lunar energy is known as chitta shakti. Prana shakti or the solar energy is responsible for the movement of the body and the sense organs and the senses. And chitta shakti is responsible for the functioning of the mind and all the different mental faculties. And it is the management of these both forms of energy which is the purpose of Hatha yoga. And therefore, in the traditional scheme of Hatha yoga, the main practices were of purification and cleansing, cleaning the body from toxins, detoxification. And these cleansing techniques of Hatha yoga detoxify the body from mouth to anus. They activate the flow of prana shakti through the channels in the body and they awaken different psychic centers or chakras of the body and they stimulate the production of different hormones from pineal gland and pituitary gland. And this is the range of Hatha yoga. So the combination of physical postures and cleansing techniques and chakra activation techniques constitute Hatha yoga. And Raja yoga is to manage the subtle influences, subtle mental behaviors. And we shall be in the coming days practicing some of the important and useful practices of Hatha yoga and Raja yoga during the morning sessions. To have that first hand experience of the practical yoga combining Hatha and Raja systems together. Raja yoga comprises of 5 major steps in yoga. The meaning of Raja yoga is eightfold path, meaning it has 8 limbs. But these 8 limbs actually control the behavior and the expression of body, energy, mind, behavior, and attitude. If you look at the asana of Raja yoga, Patanjali has defined asana as a posture in which you are comfortable and steady. You are sitting on a chair, that is an asana, where you are comfortable and you are steady. You might be sitting with your legs crossed, and that is an asana, where I am comfortable and steady. Yesterday, walking through Plaza de San Marcos, I saw one man like a statue in the Caesar pose. That was an asana. He was still, perfectly still in whatever posture he was. I mean, asana is that posture in which you are at ease with yourself, which means that the body has to come to the point of perfect ease and comfort with the practice of postures. So once body come to that point of ease and comfort, all the imbalances, physical imbalances and stresses and tensions have gone. And the ease and relaxation of the body is the symptom of a proper physical body. So that perfect harmony of the body is the outcome of asana. Another component of Raja Yoga is pranayama, the energy structure. And in this, the ultimate goal is to balance the energies. Then the management of mind through pratyahara, dharana and dhyana. Gradual sublimation of the mental awareness from gross to subtle to transcendental. The attitude, managing that with yamas or the proper code of conduct, and the, what was the next one?
Yama.
Attitude and behavior. Behavior to be modified with the practice of niyamas. So the basic practices of Hatha Yoga and Raja Yoga develop the personality at all levels, from behavior aspect to mental aspect. And yoga is a very vast subject. Concluding now, yoga is a very vast subject. In the coming days, we shall be discussing about the various components and practices of yoga and their application in our life to improve the quality of our life. And this practice ultimately gives a hope in life for the betterment of ourselves. It is not necessary to become a yogi, but it is important to connect with the qualities that are inherent in our life. And the connection with the qualities inherent is what will make us into an awakened and realized human being. And you have to put that effort in transforming the barren land of your life into a flowering garden. Once a man brought a barren piece of land, purchased it. When he brought the land, there was nothing except stones and rocks and weeds. And he put in a lot of work and made that piece of land into a very beautiful garden. So many people used to come when the garden was complete to admire it. One day a priest comes to see the garden, and he was so happy to see this beautiful garden that he exclaimed, "God's creation is wonderful. Look at this beautiful garden that God has created." And the man said, "Sorry, God did not create this. I have done it." "You should have seen this piece of land when God owned it."
Dovevi vedere com'era questo pezzo di terra quando Dio era il proprietario.
And now that I am the owner, I have made this into a garden. Well, in the same manner, you can also try to convert our life into a beautiful garden of which we all can be proud, with the practice and the right application of wisdom and creativity through yoga. And in the coming days, we hope to equip ourselves with the right tools to bring this change in the plot of land in which we live. So till then, Hari Om, Tat Sat.